Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Andrew Leonard, senior technology and business writer for Salon.com, and your moderator for tonight's program. And now it's my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel laureate economist, professor at Columbia University, and author of the new book, Freefall, America, Free Markets, and the Sinking of the World Economy. When introducing Professor Stiglitz, it's easy to become overwhelmed by the quality of his resume. In 1979, he won the John Bates Clark Award, given at that time biannually to the most promising economist under the age of 40. He has served as chairman of President Bill Clinton's Council of Economic Advisors and as chief economist of the World Bank. He is one of the most widely cited economists alive, as well as an author of bestsellers aimed at the general public, including Globalization and Its Discontents and The Roaring Nineties. And of course, he was awarded the Nobel Memorial Prize in Economics in 2001. But inside that resume lies something more important than awards or titles. Professor Stiglitz has consistently been a critic of the consensus wisdom and economic orthodoxy, and he has just as consistently been proven correct. In the Clinton administration, he warned against changes to accounting laws that ended up fueling the dot-com bubble and facilitating the bookkeeping manipulations of Enron and WorldCom. As chief economist of the World Bank, he was such a strong critic of the Washington consensus, that prescription of deregulation and privatization for the developing world, that he got himself fired. 10 years later, no one takes the Washington consensus seriously. In fact, those countries that followed its precepts most closely ended up suffering the worst during the recent financial crisis. Stiglitz has been warning for years that if the trend towards deregulation and the ethos of Wall Street knows best, promulgated ever since the Reagan Revolution, continued without halt, we would face a dire reckoning. Right again. But perhaps his most profound contribution is the work that won him his Nobel Prize. His explanation of what is known as information asymmetry, the idea that different parties to an economic transaction possess different levels of information about that transaction, poked a gaping, impossible-to-ignore hole in the so-called efficient markets theory that is at the heart of free market fundamentalism. That's some nice work. I hope we'll talk all about these things, but before we get into that, can I just say I'm surprised you're not parading down the street every day waving a big I told you so banner. In 1992, you were arguing that the securitization of mortgages would lead to disaster. In Freefall, you connect the dots between concerns you've had for years and the developments that led to the global economic crisis. So maybe a good place to start would be to recapitulate that. How did we get here, and why shouldn't it have come as a surprise?
Well, in a sense, the only surprise to me was that so many people were surprised. I was in the embarrassing position in 2007 there's an annual meeting in Davos where a lot of what I call the muckety-mucks get together. And I had forecast in 2005 and 2006 that what I thought was a bubble was going to break, that what was fueling the American economy was very unbalanced. About somewhere between 2/3 and 80% of all American growth was related to real estate. And you can't have an economy that is that dependent on one sector. Housing is important, but 80% between the actual real estate investment and people taking money out of real estate related to the bubble. And so I had been forecasting that there were going to be these problems, and by 2007, it still hadn't happened, and it was very, you could say, almost embarrassing. And I gave a talk in which I said, you know, there are two interpretations. Either my theory was wrong, or when the bubble breaks, it's going to be all the worse. And, of course, I suggested that it was the latter interpretation. I've been saved. It was, in fact, unfortunately, true that when the bubble broke, it was worse. What was going on, in a way, was fairly simple. What this bubble was keeping the American economy going. People were taking money out of their house. People were living beyond their means. So this average savings rate, the average household savings rate, had fallen to zero. You know, and that's not obviously not sustainable. And as one of my predecessors, as the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisers, said, that which is not sustainable won't be sustained, and it wasn't. So we now, in a sense, the story is very simple. The bubble broke, and what we've had since then, it broke in the beginning of 2007, and what we've had since then is almost a predictable consequence. It's like a slow train wreck. You can see everything. I thought I could see everything happening. Bernanke and the Fed didn't want to see it because they didn't want to believe that they had allowed this bubble to grow. And so they kept saying, oh, don't worry, we've got the problem contained. Everything is under control. But the banks had made really bad lending, including moving a lot of this off balance sheet in a way to hide it from the regulators, from the investors, because they didn't want them to know what was going on. But the irony was that they did such a good job of hiding it that they themselves didn't know with their own balance sheet. And so they knew that they couldn't know the balance sheet of anybody else. So that's why the whole trust broke down. No bank would be willing to lend to anybody else because they didn't know who was bankrupt and who was not. And the credit flow then paralyzed, and then the whole economy would have frozen if it had been that the federal government came to the rescue, and governments in other countries came to the rescue. And with the backing of government, they could say, okay, now we'll lend if we know that the government is standing behind it, that there's this guarantee. But one of the things I try to do in the book is, I use this metaphor, is like peeling back an onion. Okay, now we've described what happened. It's a very simple story. And the interesting thing, it's a very old-fashioned story. There have been lots of bubbles in history. In fact, the history of capitalism is filled with bubbles that break and the disaster. But when I say peeling back an onion, you have to ask why. Why did these problems arise? And to put it in very briefly, the simple explanation is that the bankers and the banks had incentives for bad lending. They had incentives for short-sighted behavior, excessive risk-taking, and the one thing economists agree on is that incentives matter. I mean, the bankers also agree, but they focus on what they view as the positive aspects of incentives. What I focused on was the negative aspects of these incentives. In fact, again, it was a little bit embarrassing because, you know, when I talk to my students, I explain how there were these incentives for excessive risk-taking. And again, I was worried that we hadn't seen the manifestations of this bad lending that the theory predicted. So the implication is either we have to change our lectures or the problem was coming. So fortunately, I don't have to rewrite my lecture. They behave badly just like we said they should. But again, you have to ask the question, isn't capitalism pride itself about in finding good incentive structures? You're not supposed to have incentives that are so disastrous. And the answer to that, you'll have to buy the book to figure that out. But anyway, the whole chain. But then the other part of the story is, since we've had these problems over and over and over again, why didn't the regulators stop them? There was one period in our history, in the history of capitalism actually, in which we haven't had these problems in our financial sector. And that was the 30 years after the Great Depression, when we adopted regulations, and they worked. But then, beginning around 1980, they began to strip away the regulations, and they didn't adopt the new regulations that were needed when, you know, for credit default swaps and the new products. And so without the regulations, the bankers have the incentives that I just described to do all the things that the excessive risk-taking, short-sighted behavior. Then you have to ask the question, well, why did we strip away the regulations? Well, the answer to that is actually, part of it is very simple. The bankers saw this as a real opportunity for making money. And that's, you might say, self-interest, greed, and all that. But the other question is, there are five lobbyists from the financial sector for every congressman. So it's very hard for them to get away from somebody telling them that what they ought to do. But the other part of it is where I have to blame my colleagues in the economics profession. Not all economists got it wrong, but a lot of them did, and they provided arguments that politicians used and people in the industry used for stripping it away. And the basic argument was a very simple one. It's a variant of Adam Smith that markets, unfettered markets, always lead to efficient outcomes. And that's why you could have people like Alan Greenspan saying, there's no such thing as a bubble, a little froth in the economy. The result of that gave, you might say, succor to those who didn't want to engage in regulation. So you both stripped away regulation and you appointed people who didn't believe in regulation, and they could feel good because they were just doing what they said economic theory said you ought to be doing. But this goes back to what you were saying. The theories that said that markets work perfectly were all based on very simplistic models of perfect competition, perfect markets, and perfect information. My own work, like I did with my colleague at Bruce Greenwald at Columbia, is that we showed that the reason that when there's imperfect information, asymmetric information, and these other problems, the reason that the invisible hand, the idea that that the pursuit of self-interest would lead, as if by an invisible hand, to the well-being of everybody in society, the reason the invisible hand often seemed invisible was that it wasn't there. And I don't think today anybody would claim that the pursuit of self-interest by the bankers, which is sometimes called greed, has led to the well-being of all society. And yet this was the central notion taught in almost every graduate school in the country.
I think I'm supposed to announce every 15 minutes that we're on the radio, and I think that was a 15-minute answer.
I'll try to be shorter.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Nobel laureate economist Dr. Joseph Stiglitz, who is discussing the global economic crisis and the outlook for future prosperity. And while you were giving that question, we got enough good questions for you to be here for several days. So, but following up on that, kind of the last point where you were talking about the kind of intellectual justification. I mean, earlier you said that why this happened was because bankers wanted to make money, but they had this justification that they were getting from academia that has basically been dominant for the last 40 years. And one would think that the current crisis would have shaken that dominance enough for something else to replace it. But if you follow the political debate and you look, you know, Wall Street just spent more money lobbying this year than they've ever have before. It's as if that dominance has hardly been shaken. I mean, in your book, you say this is an opportunity for change. How do we go about making that change happen? How do we break this hold that is still, you know, beyond the grave reaching after us?
Well, I suppose I had hoped at the beginning of the crisis that this was going to be the one silver lining in the cloud that, just like the Great Depression 75 years ago, woke people up to the notion that markets are not self-adjusting. In fact, it was very interesting. In John Kenneth Galbraith's memoirs, he describes how when he first came to Harvard, most of the faculty believed that you shouldn't do anything. They were really supporters of Hubert Hoover as the economy was going into, not only going into the Great Depression, but it was persisting. Remember, it started in 29, and it didn't really get over until World War II. And what's so interesting about that is that the same kind of debate that the country is going through right now about deficits and should we withdraw the stimulus because the deficits are getting too large was going on there. One of the reasons the Great Depression lasted so long was that, in fact, in 1937, the stimulus of the New Deal was cut back. States like California mm-hmm. were in very bad shape, and so they cut back spending, and that was like a negative stimulus. And so, in fact, the next stimulus wasn't there, and the economy that had been recovering went back into recession.
Do you see that same thing happening again with the current deficit talk rising up again?
Yes, I do. I mean, I'm very much worried about it. And some, you know, sort of the same kinds of mindset that said markets take care of it and are self-correcting are now saying you got to withdraw the stimulus. It's even worse in Europe. Let me say, I just came back from Europe, and it was also in Greece, where there's this real irony where the Greek government, like the other governments in Europe and in the United States, have had very large increases in the deficit to bail out the banks and to keep the economy going as a result of the economic weaknesses that are a result of the banks' mistakes. So what is, you know, rather than sending you a thank you note, you would have thought, well, the financial sector ought to send a thank you note, thank you for saving us. We understand it's been very expensive, and we'll help by giving you, you should impose a separate, additional tax for us to help you get out of the huge debt that we are responsible for. Rather than the thank you note, what are they doing in Greece? They are in Spain and Portugal. They're attacking these countries for having too large of a debt and deficit caused by their own actions. And so they're mounting a speculative attack, and the response of the financial sector is, they're pretending this speculative attack comes out of nowhere, and they say, if you want the speculative attack to go away, you have to cut wages in the government, cut spending, you have to have very big reductions in spending, and when we're talking really, really big cutbacks. And if they, of course, all do that, what's going to happen? It's back to Hoover kind of policies. The economy is going to get weaker, and the deficit is not going to go away. Because the economy is going to be weaker, government revenues are going to go down, and they might, you know, the deficit might get a little bit smaller, but in fact, because the economy is going down, whenever the economy goes down, the deficit gets bigger. It's not optimistic. I mean, I think what I was, you know, I often begin my talks by saying, economists, the economics is called the dismal science. And these last 2 years have been a field day for economists. We've never had it so good because, in fact, it is really dismal. The good thing about this particular session is that it's before dinner. As an after-dinner speech, this is really gives you indigestion. So at least this is before dinner.
Well, one of the questions I just received was how it was basically asking for a pick-me-up. You know, what do you say to the average person to give them some sense of optimism about our capability of confronting these problems.
Well, I suppose that one note of optimism is that every downturn has eventually come to an end. you know, when the economy was in free fall, even at that moment when a lot of people had the sense of this is never going to end, I've watched lots of crises. You know, America, this is a new experience for most Americans, but as chief economist, I used to watch all over the world the same kind of experience of free fall, of the economy going down, not knowing when it was going to stop. But eventually it does come to a stop. So that's the one note of optimism. It's not exactly something you feel exuberant about, knowing that eventually it will come to an end. I think what we should feel is that if we do the right thing, we can shorten the downturn, and we can make sure it is not as bad as it otherwise would be.
I think that leads very naturally to a response to a number of questions I have sitting here, all of which seem to be curious about what you think of the way Obama has handled the economy. And we can split that into two parts. There are questions asking about the response to the question of financial reform and the more day-to-day handling of the economy. I mean, there is a question, what letter grade would you give for his handling of the economy? We could maybe take the stimulus into account on that one.
Okay, well first, when I get asked that question, I always explain that as teachers, we grade on the curve. And so compared to what happened before, you have to give them an A+. on the other hand, that's a pretty low benchmark. there are basically four issues. Maybe I can go through those very quickly. Issue of the stimulus to the economy, dealing with the mortgages, the bank restructuring, and the financial sector regulation. So to very, very brief, and you get a different grade on each of these parts. One of my criticisms of Bush was that he focused only on throwing money at the banks without thinking about what imposing any conditions, and he just somehow an extreme version of trickle-down economics. You throw enough money, everybody will be benefited. And I've seen trickle-down economics. It doesn't work. And at least Obama began by saying, let's do something about the real economy. Let's stimulate the economy. So that was very good. Just over a year that he passed, that we got the stimulus. Many people have been upset and said, look, it didn't work because look at the unemployment. It's almost 10%. It's actually worse than that because more than one out of six Americans who would like a full-time job can't get one right now. And if you look at particular demographic groups like Afro-American youth, the unemployment rates are horrendous. I mean, they're close to one out of two. So, I mean, these are really terrible statistics. Long-term unemployment. For the first time, more than 40% of those who are unemployed have been unemployed for more than 6 months. That's really important because that, you know, if you're unemployed for just a few weeks, you get another job and that's fine. But if you're unemployed for more than 6 months, your skills attenuate, your savings account gets drained, and really that's when the suffering occurs. The problem, my criticism of the stimulus was it wasn't big enough. And I said that at the time. Even the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors said we needed $1.2 trillion. But Obama wasn't given that choice. The paper that he was given gave a choice between $800 billion and $600 billion. And he pushed for the larger number. The design was not as good a design as it could have been. We didn't. I thought they should have given more aid to the stakes. It's very clear now that they should have given more aid to the stakes. And you know, my view was that if you don't do that, since the stakes have balanced budget frameworks, as their revenues go down, and it was predictable that they were going to go down markedly, they're either going to have to cut back spending or raise taxes, and that's a negative stimulus. Why do you want to have a negative stimulus? And these are jobs that will be destroyed very quickly, and that would be bad for morale. So my priority was give more money to aid the stakes. Instead, they gave a tax cut. About a third of the money went into a tax cut, and we knew from the Bush tax cut of February 2008, the tax cuts don't work very well. Reason is obvious. People had a huge overhang of debt, a lot of job uncertainty, and in response, they saved the money. And it's good for their personal security, but the nature of a stimulus is you have to spend it to stimulate. And so that was the best part of the program, and it has worked. Let me be clear, it has worked. Unemployment, if he hadn't done that, would have been probably around 12%, and now it's 10%. But they underestimated the severity of the problem. They thought the unemployment was going to be 10% without the stimulus, and they would bring it down to 8%. The mortgage, before the crisis, as the crisis was getting worse, and Bush was throwing money at the banks, I said it was like giving a mass blood transfusion to somebody suffering from very serious internal hemorrhaging. The whole problem had started with the foreclosures, and Bush didn't want to do anything about that. Finally, Obama did something about it, but again, it wasn't enough, and it didn't do anything about the underwater mortgages, the mortgages where people owe more money than the value of the house. And it's a very, very big problem in California, but over the country as a whole, now about one out of four mortgages are underwater. And he didn't do anything about that. Reason, the bankers didn't want him to do anything about it. Why? If you restructure the mortgages, the banks would have to recognize that they had made bad loans. And they wanted to maintain the fiction that things were going to recover. And so they didn't want to have to deal with the problem, push it down the road. The result of that is there will be more foreclosures in 2010 than in 2009 and 2008. They're just increasing. The numbers that are expected are between 2.5 and 3.5 million. And, of course, as long as that happens, we're not going to be out of the woods. The third problem is, the third issue was the bank restructuring. Here, the big mistake he made was there was no vision of what kind of a financial system we wanted. No vision of what we want a financial system for. And therefore, no sense of how we needed to restructure to do what it's supposed to do. You know, and just to give you a feeling, the financial system is supposed to allocate capital and manage risk. And our financial system misallocated capital, squandered it. You know, no government has ever wasted money on the scale that our financial sector has wasted money. And it didn't manage risk, it created risk. A small part of a financial system was doing what it was supposed to do, and we ought to, you know, we ought to realize that some of it was really doing the venture capital firms that sort of you were involved, you know about, or you know, and that created the new enterprises that are so strong in California. Those were doing what they were supposed to do, channel money to new enterprises, trying to figure out who are good entrepreneurs and who are not. But that's not what most of the financial market was doing. It was speculating, it was gambling, it was creating these crazy securities. And yet, when it came for the bailout, where did the money go? not to the banks that were actually doing lending, not to the part out of the financial sector that was doing what it was supposed to doing, but to the big gambling houses. And the result of that is 140 banks went bankrupt last year. We let them go because they're small and they were doing what they're supposed to. You know, these are the institutions that are doing lending. They obviously didn't do a perfect job or they wouldn't be bankrupt. But meanwhile, money, massive amount of money went to save the big banks. So the result of this is we have a more distorted financial system than we did at the beginning of the crisis. Problems of too big to fail have become even bigger. And the final thing is regulation. You know, I began by saying we had stripped away the regulation. We hadn't adopted regulations that we need for the 21st century. We've done almost nothing. So in terms of those, you know, those four issues, two of them were really starks, but not big enough. The other two, we really haven't done what we should be doing.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Nobel laureate economist Dr. Joseph Stiglitz, who is discussing the global economic crisis and the outlook for future prosperity. That last answer touched on what would you say at a Tea Party convention?
If they invited me. Well, actually, that's really at the core of the book. It's a good question. You know, a lot of the book, there have been a lot of books written about the crisis, and most of them are accounts of who did what when. You know, what happened in the 4 days that Lehman Brothers collapsed or Bear Stearns collapsed. And the kind of stories, you know, what would have happened if he hadn't had to go to the bathroom at the critical moment and, you know, he wasn't there, went to say the right thing. And they're very gripping. My book is really an attempt to see this as a battle of ideas and how ideas shaped what we did before the crisis, and flawed ideas led to the mistaken policies of deregulation, mistaken policies of the Fed, of believing that there was no such thing as a bubble, and then flawed ideas also were very important in shaping the response. The big thesis of the book, in a sense, is that we need to get the right balance between market and government. And if we don't do that, we're not going. You won't have a successful economy. And so, in terms of the Tea Party, I would have pointed out that almost everyone in the financial sector agrees that if we had not come, the government had not come to the rescue of the banks, we would be in another deep recession, in another depression. So that government is absolutely essential. But if the government is essential for saving the economy, then the government has to prevent the economy from getting into situations where they have to be saved. This has been a very, very expensive proposition. Our national debt will be trillions of dollars larger as a result of the mismanagement of the economy. And so even if you want believing in keeping you focus on the deficit, even if you focus on that, this kind of mismanagement of the economy, allowing banks to engage in unfettered risk-taking, is reckless. And so just like the banks are reckless, the proposition that you can strip away government, pretending to, is reckless. And I'd also point out to them that the government has played a very creative role as well. Most of them in the room are probably use the internet. And they probably don't realize that the internet exists because of government research, that it funded the basic research that led to the internet, led to most of the things that have innovations that have extended life, biotechnology and all of that. The private sector brought these ideas to the market, plays a very pivotal role in bringing these ideas to the market, but the basic research is something that the market really can't or doesn't do. And so we have to get that balance. If you don't do the basic research, the private sector has nothing to bring to market. And so that would be the message that I would try to, whether they listen or not is another question.
Well, that's part of the dynamic, though, is that the simple, two small steps that have been taken so far, I mean, we go back to all of your points about the economy, have spawned such a intense reaction that it's hard to even imagine what, if your full platform had been adopted, what we'd be facing now.
Well, no, I think that part of the resentment is because the medicine was in too small a dose, that the economy hasn't recovered, and the basic proposition that to economists is natural is very hard for a lot of people to understand. We call it the counterfactual, what the world would have been but for this dose of medicine. So the notion that, what a lot of people see is before the stimulus, unemployment was 7.5%. Now it's almost 10%. And very simple causal, very simple reasoning said, well, the stimulus caused it to increase. Well, hopefully in our high schools and our grade schools, we explain that's not the way you ought to think about it. You have to ask what it would have been had we not had the stimulus. And that's why I emphasized before, it would have been, unemployment would have been 12%. So the stimulus has worked. But explaining that is not that easy. The second point is that a lot of the anger is directed at the banks and the bank bailout and a confusion between the stimulus and the bank bailout. Two very different programs. And as I was saying, the bank bailout was conducted in a way that I'm very critical of that as well, and for an obvious reason. The president came to American people and said we needed the bank bailout, not because we love the banks, but in order to enable the banks to start lending. But they didn't do that. They took our money and they paid it out in bonuses and dividends. We said they were going to, this was for recapitalization. But how do you recapitalize money with money that as you pour it in, it pours out? Obviously, they weren't using it for recapitalization. And very simple point was that this was consistent with their incentives. Their incentives were to take out as much as they could because they knew how bad the shape the banks were in. So the way we ought to have thought about it is in 1996, we reformed welfare for the poor. And when we reformed welfare for the poor, we said, if you're going to get welfare payments from the government, you have to either look for a job or go into a training program to increase your skills. But when we put the banks on welfare, and we got to be clear, it was a bigger welfare program than the total amount that we will spend on the poor over a century. The amount the welfare payments for the banks is larger than what we will be spending on poor people literally over a century. So this is a huge amount. But when we did that, we didn't put any conditions. And we should have. The bank said, well, trust us. The point is, look at how they behaved before that. We had every reason not to trust them. But then we made a second mistake. not only to give them money without conditions so that they didn't use it for the reason. When we gave them money, they gave us pieces of paper and back, you know, preferred shares. But quite frankly, we got cheated. The Congressional Oversight Panel that looked at the value of the pieces of paper, the preferred shares that we got back, pointed out that we got back about 67 cents from the banks for every dollar we gave the banks. And on some of the more recent deals, we got less than 50 cents on the dollar. So when you look at that, you have to be a little angry. And so the Tea Party reaction is understandable given that part of the program, but we shouldn't confuse that with the stimulus.
I have several questions here from the audience, all touching on aspects of how we would go about fixing the system. How we could, one asks, is there a way to, that re-regulation could make the financial sector a smaller part of the economy? Another is, how would you change incentives to encourage economic actors to act with a longer-term view? Another is, very specifically, what are your views on requiring all derivatives transactions to take place on an open, transparent derivatives exchange? So all of these fit, I think, generally under the rubric of re-regulating and changing incentives and giving us a platform to go forward on.
Yeah, I think clearly we do need to have a new regulatory framework that I describe in the book a fairly comprehensive agenda of what is needed. And you can begin with the issue that I raised before, incentives. You know, it's the one thing that economists agree on, that incentives matter. They're not the only thing in life, but they certainly matter. So we have to change the incentive structures that the bankers have so that they have incentives for a longer-term behavior and incentives not to engage in excessive risk-taking. But we also have to say change incentives at the organizational level. You know, we have banks that are too big to fail. It's a one-way bet. If they gamble and they win, they walk off with the profits. If they gamble and lose, we pick up the tab. So clearly we have to do something about too big to fail banks. And almost every economist recognizes this. And it's not just too big to fail depository institutions. AIG was a too big to fail insurance company.
General Motors.
All of these become too big to fail, and that was one of the original intents of antitrust legislation. But we haven't really done what we should have done. So that's, you might say, the broad issue of incentives. Part of the problem is transparency. How can the market work? How can it provide discipline if people, investors, don't know what's going on? And the banks may not have been very good at allocating capital, managing risk, but they were very creative in deceptive accounting. I have to give them credit. It was very innovative. And you've been hearing some stuff recently about the creativity that they used in the Greek accounts, but it's pervasive. You know, originally, a lot of this was creative accounting to try to avoid taxation, what many people view it as a laudable goal. But they used that same ingenuity then to try to deceive investors and wound up actually deceiving themselves. So we need more transparency. But the interesting thing is, in response to the crisis, what the banks demanded was less transparency, changing the accounting standards so that we know even less about what is going on inside the banks. And we gave in. So actually, there's been a move towards less transparency. Third thing, issues of structure, conflicts of interest. And that's where they made a very big mistake in repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act, which separated commercial banks from investment banks. And I opposed it. I was in the Clinton administration at the time. And a whole set of reasons why it was a bad idea, that it would lead to even larger banks. You want commercial banks, the banks that take your money, to be conservative. You know, when you put your debit card into your ATM machine and it says insufficient funds, you want it to be insufficient funds because you don't have enough in your account, not because the bank doesn't have enough money. If the bank's engaging in excessive risk-taking, there's a risk. And that's where Paul Volcker, former chairman of the Federal Reserve, has been very forthright in saying we have to stop the proprietary trading of these, trading on their own accounts, speculating on their own accounts of commercial banks. And then finally, we have to deal with all these other kinds of forms of excessive risk-taking, including the credit default swaps. And just to pick out that one point, the bailout of one company, AIG, some of you may have followed that in the beginning, it was $89 billion for one company. But when you weren't looking, that doubled. So the total amount now is around $180 billion. That's an amount that is so large it's hard to fathom. I mean, put it in a couple way of thinking about it. It's more than all the aid that goes to all the developing countries from all the developed countries over a two-year period. Or it's more than the United States will be giving to Africa in a quarter of a century. And this went without any public discussion, without any public debate, you know, almost without, you know, anybody noticing it, to one company. And it was done in a very non-transparent way. The question was, what did AIG do with the money? It just disappeared. Well, AIG didn't want to say, but the interesting thing is, who owns AIG? We do. We are 80% owners. So you would have thought, since we own it, shouldn't we find out where the money went? Government doesn't want to say, the Federal Reserve didn't want to say. For an obvious reason, you know, one of the advantages of living in New York is you hear rumors of where the money went, and people talk. I was pretty sure where it was going, and I put some pressure on people in Congress, and they demanded. We now know where the money went. The largest single piece of that money, $13 billion, went to Goldman Sachs. And there was only one person at the meeting who was not from the government in the discussion of the bailout of AIG, and that was the head of Goldman Sachs. Maybe a surprise, maybe a coincidence, but you might think. The other big recipients were foreign banks. And it's nice for us to give foreign aid to France and Germany, but I still think that we should be giving foreign aid to Africa, poor countries, not to France and Germany. If these other banks were at risk, then their governments would have come to the rescue.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Nobel laureate economist Dr. Joseph Stiglitz, who is discussing the global economic crisis and the outlook for future prosperity. I want to jump right back to your mentioning of Glass-Steagall, because at that time, when you were in the Clinton administration, one of the lead proponents of repealing Glass-Steagall was Larry Summers, the Secretary of the Treasury at that time, who is now in the administration again. And in your book, you are pretty critical of the team that Obama has collected around him on economic policy, believing that they are too close to Wall Street. Do you think that explains the tentativeness of the attempts to regulate so far? And just to put a counterpoint on that, you also mentioned earlier that Christy Romer did say the stimulus should be $1.2 billion. I read...
Trillion.
$1.3 billion. Trillion.
These numbers are so large that they're hard to say. I understand.
I've made that mistake so many times writing. It's very embarrassing. In The New Yorker just did a profile of Paul Krugman, and there's a quote from an administration staffer who was in the meetings where the Senate was haggling down the stimulus at the last end. And he said, it's very simple. We were not going to get 60 votes for a bigger stimulus. It just the political reality was that. So on one side, you have the political reality that there's these incredible limitations placed on whatever the administration tries to do. And on the other side, too close to Wall Street?
No, these are very hard issues, very difficult to be sure about what the answer is. And in my book, Freefall, I try to go through the alternative interpretations. There's one more that you didn't mention, and that was there was a concern, particularly at the beginning, of trying to maintain stability, confidence. Because remember, a lot of people in Wall Street did not want to believe that they had been so stupid. Understandable. That they didn't want to believe that. They didn't want to believe that there was a bubble, that they had managed to lend using bubble prices as collateral. And so, you know, and those who were responsible for deregulation didn't want to believe that their theories had been torn apart and that everything that they had been fighting for had proven to be so wrong. And you know, in their pictures, you know, in their biographies, the thing that they're proudest of is deregulation or making sure that derivatives would never be regulated. That's what they thought were their achieving. So very understandable that they didn't want to believe that there would be such a big failure. And so there was this hope that the bubble was not a bubble, but the bubble was a reality. The high prices were reality, that we were just having a temporary nightmare. And we would wake up from the nightmare, and if you give enough speeches and tell everybody everything is great, green sprouts, just go to the shopping mall, everything would revive, and we'd be back into this bubble. Now, to me, that sounded crazy. As crazy as the bubble itself, because one of the aspects of the bubble was that prices had been going up and the incomes of most Americans had been going down. I mean, this is something that a lot of people don't realize, that the real income of most Americans by 2007, 2008 was below what it was in 2000, and adjusted for inflation. So you have prices going up and incomes going down. Once interest rates went from the low level that they've been at 1% or 2%, it was predictable that there would be problems. So, but to put yourself in their mindset was a little bit of a irrational pessimism, not irrational exuberance. And so let's try to maintain stability, not disturb the system. And so what is the best way to do that? Put the same team in place, you know, put the kind of people who Wall Street loved, and for a very good reason, because they had been responsible for the deregulation that the rest of us realized had caused all these problems. So it was almost strategic in that sense, but based on this fundamental misjudgment about whether it was whether what was a true world. Was the bubble true, or was the breaking of the bubble the real reality?
I have a question that asks, if Geithner and Summers were fired tomorrow, would you have suggestions for who to replace them?
Well, actually, there are a lot of people that know a lot about, you know, financial markets. I think one of the mistakes that was made is to think of that there are just a few people that can do the job. You know, one of the metaphors I give in the book is that, and this is partly an answer to the previous question, those in the financial sector really had two views of what had gone on. One view was there was a once-in-a-hundred-year tsunami that overcame us. Nothing was really wrong, and so nothing needs to be fixed. It is unreasonable to think that you can protect yourself against every risk. If you did that, you would never cross the street. So this view said nothing is wrong. Something happened to us that we could not control. But my view was very clear. It wasn't something that happened to the finance sector. It's something the finance sector did to the rest of us. And that was what I've described before. The second interpretation was that there was just a little problem in our plumbing. Our pipes got clogged. And when your pipes get clogged, what do? You call the same plumber that put in the pipes in the first place. He knows where all those queer, you know, strange kinks are. And so he knows where all the problems are. You know he's going to overcharge you. You know that after he fixes it, you're going to have some more problems. But if you want to get it repaired quickly, you call the same guy. The alternative is to get somebody who really understands that the plumbing was put in the wrong way with the wrong kind of pipes, and you really ought to rethink the whole plumbing. So it seemed to me that you know, the alternative are some people who have been more critical of the financial system, and there are lots of people who've taken that stance, and obviously, if you go down that route, you will annoy some of those in Wall Street, because some of those in Wall Street do not want regulation. And you have to understand that. You know, you're not going to be pleasing the people who don't want regulation by appointing somebody like Paul Volcker who knows that you need regulation. Interesting thing, coming from New York, I should mention, though, is how many people in the financial market in New York are critical. Because what they feel is we've created an unlevel playing field within the financial market. The big banks are, in effect, being subsidized by government because they're too big to fail. They get capital at a lower cost, and that's distorting our whole economy. So I find it just so remarkable how much my criticisms, and you know, I don't tone them down too much, how resonant the criticisms that I've been raising of the financial market, how many people in Wall Street actually agree with me.
They've seen your I told you so banner. I want to move. We have a really good question here that moves us quite far away from Wall Street. But I think you do touch a little bit on in your book on, you know, how we reorient the economy in different ways. And this question says, it is clear that the global scale of human activity already places too many demands on natural resources. Economic growth will compound this ecological balance problem. Why are economic advisors so slow to move beyond the, quote, economic growth equals prosperity paradigm? Which is a fairly broad question, but...
It's part of... I actually addressed some of this issue in the last part of the book, because one of the points that I try to raise is that while we've been addressing our short-run problems, the problems of the crisis, the long-run problems, like the environmental problems, haven't gone away. They've continued to get worse, except for one thing, that we now have less resources to deal with the problem because of the enormous amounts that we squandered on the banks and the enormous cost of the dealing with the crisis. Before the crisis, I had been asked to chair an international commission on the measurement of economic performance and social progress. And one of the things that our commission, which Mark Chassin, who's coming here on Thursday, was one of the key members of the commission, one of the things that we emphasized was that our measure of GDP really is not a good measure of economic performance. And one aspect of that, it was brought out by the crisis, which is that, for instance, before the crisis, 40% of all corporate profits were in finance. And those numbers were just made up. They're all a mirage. They're all phony numbers. And investment was all based on bubble prices, because the largest part of investment was in real estate. And moreover, our measure didn't reflect the lack of sustainability. Well, even more important than economic sustainability is environmental sustainability. And our price system is very distorted. We treat as free something that's very scarce, all kinds of environmental goods, including the air. And so the result of this is, you know, the price of a carbon emission should be something like $80 a ton. The price is zero. Well, when you have a big, important input like that mispriced, all the other things are mispriced, and so we're not getting a good measure. If we had the right prices, it would provide greater incentives to economize on things that spoil the environment. There are lots of aspects of what would be a good measure of social progress and economic performance that don't use put a lot of demands on the environment. A meeting like this as part of GDP doesn't put a big strain on the environment. So the bottom line of what I'm trying to say is that if we correct some of our measurements, we would direct incentives or our attention to in ways that would lead to are not having as bad an adverse effect on the environment as we are currently.
Unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where there is time for only one last question. I'm going to merge two, though, for, I think, to represent a few questions in here. There's some direct questions of kind of consumer advice. One takes off of the Move Your Money campaign. You know, should I bank at my small local bank instead of a giant multinational? What's the difference? Another just asks, in view of present concerns about the future soundness of the dollar, the pound, and the euro, what might you suggest as a possible safe place for any assets one might still own? So we can all leave here with some investment advice.
Okay. Good questions. First, I mean, I assume the people probably asking that question have savings less than the amount that is the maximum under FDIC insurance. And therefore, any bank which is FDIC insured, no matter how small, is perfectly safe. The government is backing it just like it's backing the big banks. And so that's part of the motivation for people moving money to smaller banks, because and hopefully that will put pressure on the bigger banks to act in a more responsible way. I would say, see whether they're engaged in predatory lending, whether they're engaged in kind of what I would call almost credit card deception, which has been, what was their position in fighting on the credit card abuses? Or on the other kinds of predatory lending that have been so important. On the more global, broader issue, A lot of concern going right now, given the deficit, the ballooning of the Fed's balance sheet, about inflation. And one of the things that we did, one of the innovations under the Clinton administration, that was resisted by the financial sector, was the introduction of inflation-indexed bonds. So anybody worried about inflation, there are government bonds that are protected against inflation that will go up in value with inflation. That is the, you know, if you're worried about that, that's some place to put your money.
Our thanks to Dr. Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel laureate economist, professor at Columbia University, and author of the new book, Freefall: America, Free Markets, and the Sinking of the World Economy. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. A reminder that at the conclusion of the program, Professor Stiglitz will be signing books outside this room, so please allow him to make his way there as quickly as possible. I'm Andrew Leonard, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned.